In 50 minutes, The Cosby Show. In just under 4 hours, the Super Bowl. And right now, the latest from Miami.
Joe Robbie Stadium awaits Super Bowl 23 between the Cincinnati Bengals and the San Francisco 49ers.
Good evening and welcome to our preview to Super Bowl 23. We've been here in Miami all week preparing for tonight's game. Unfortunately for the city, the Super Bowl has not been the only news in town. Earlier in the week, racial riots instead of football became the main story. But contrary to reports, neither the Bengals nor the 49ers have been affected by the unrest. And the focus has definitely been on winning tonight. During this preview show, we'll be joining John Smith, who will be at the team's hotels. But here with me now is Walter Payton, the only one of the three of us who has played in the Super Bowl before. Walter, welcome.
Thanks.
What are your memories of that Super Bowl just 3 years ago?
Well, I think it was all the media hype that was surrounded by the game. You were so caught up in it, you really couldn't think about football. And when the game came, it was sort of like anticlimactic because everything else had built up and the game was just something that happened.
So emotionally now, we're just 3 hours away from kickoff. How do you think the players are feeling?
Most of the players are just ready for the game to start because all week they've been anticipating this and the media have been bringing certain things into the game about players, Icky Woods shuffle, Joe Montana this and that. So the players are just ready to get out on the field because 2 weeks layoff between the game that you played last kind of makes you a little bit anxious to get in there and play again.
All right, excellent. Well, going into today's game, the bookies have made San Francisco 7-point favorites. And right now, John is at their hotel. John, how are the 49ers accepting their role as favorites?
Well, Mick, they've been very relaxed and confident all week. They've definitely been enjoying it. Right now, they're having their pre-game meal, and then they'll have a final meeting before they board the bus for the stadium. News from earlier in the week is that 34-year-old All-Pro center Randy Cross has said that this will be his last game. Also, this could be the last game as head coach for Bill Walsh, who may take on a different role with the 49ers next year. The only worry this week has been the injury to wide receiver Jerry Rice's ankle, but he's 85% fit and will play in a game of this importance. A win today will secure the title of the team of the 80s for the 49ers.
Well, during the season, both teams came across lean times, and during that time, neither looked like Super Bowl champions. But in the end, both had and did what it takes to have a shot at that title. So now let's take a brief look at the team's road to Super Bowl 23.
The 49ers opened their season against their closest rivals in the NFC, the New Orleans Saints. The bad old days in the Superdome have been consigned to the annals of the past, and the Saints pushed the Niners to the final whistle. But in the end, Joe Montana's three touchdowns were enough for a one-point victory. However, Montana injured an elbow, and the following week against the New York Giants, Steve Young got the start, adding fuel to a preseason quarterback controversy. Young struggled, and the 49ers trailed 17-13 with a minute and a half remaining. So off the bench came Montana, called his favorite play to his favorite receiver, and the rest, as they say, is history.
Montana, Rice, he's open! No flags are down, touchdown!
The following weekend saw the birth of a fatal inconsistency that almost ruined the Niners' season. At home to the winless Atlanta Falcons, Montana turned villain with three interceptions, presenting the Falcons with a shock victory. 7 days later in Seattle, Montana's hand was as hot as it had been cold the previous Sunday, with Jerry Rice once again the principal beneficiary.
They face another third down, third and three. Montana. Santana under pressure gets it away deep for Rice. He has it. Jerry Rice will go all the way. Santana going deep again. Jerry Rice with another touchdown.
After a routine win over Detroit, West Coast fans again had to suffer the bad 49ers. In a wind-affected overtime loss to Denver, an increasingly fragile Montana bailed out with bruised ribs, and in relief, Steve Young threw two interceptions, the second setting up Rich Carlos's winning kick. The uncertainty at quarterback wasn't helping the 49ers' situation.
This is tough on both of our parts to not know who's going to be in the game at what time and when and what mistakes are going to make you come out. And so you play the game a little bit different, and you approach it a little different. And I think it unfortunately takes away from our position.
1987 was Cincinnati's worst season of the decade, and the Bengals' first objective in 88 was to regain self-respect after being dubbed the Cincinnati Bungles. They very quickly did that and a whole lot more, with the combination of Boomer Esiason and Eddie Brown earning the respect of defenses around the league.
Stanley Wilson, no, on a fake and wide open is Eddie Brown. And Brown has to turn around to the end, touchdown Cincinnati.
Eddie Brown going in motion, turning it upfield as Esiason looks at him and lets it rip. Eddie Brown on the run, and Eddie Brown has it.
After 6 weeks, the Bengals led the league and were the only team still to be beaten.
We are a team that came into this season where they're going to fire the coach in his first stumble. So we have to win next week or I'm out of work.
In California, the bad 49ers were showing up more often than the good. But against the Rams, Roger Craig was brilliant.
Roger Craig, still on his feet, still running.
And against the Vikings, Steve Young added sparkle of his own.
Young comes out of here. Still on his feet is Steve Young, and still. And Steve Young still going. Young cuts back. Young cuts back. Touchdown.
In sharp contrast, they lost on national television against the Bears. Couldn't score a touchdown against the LA Raiders. And worst of all, gave away a 23-point lead in 19 disastrous minutes to the Cardinals in Phoenix. With just five games to play, the 49ers were third in their division and barely keeping their heads above water.
I have to blame us for the penalties. And that's what's killing this football team right now. Killing. And everybody's responsible. Those involved, those that coach them, and myself. That's it, gentlemen.
For Cincinnati, Week 7 brought a new experience, losing. The Bengals fell victim to the Foxborough phenomenon. Doug Flutie has never lost in the Patriots' home park. And despite New England's 2-4 record, America's favorite midget only needed a little help from his running backs and a little luck to burst the Bengals' bubble. With the unbeaten record in the books, Boomer and the Bengals proved to be merely human after all, blowing out the Oilers and Pittsburgh and then losing to Cleveland and Kansas City. After 11 games, they too had reached their lowest point. But at 8-3, they still led their division. They had also discovered the NFL's newest superstar.
He can block you on the left, he can sweep it to the right, then he pulls it to the end zone with all of his might. Oh,
my real name is Albert, and we were young. I was one and my older brother was two. And he used to call me E.E. all the time. So my mother said that I looked like a cartoon character, and she just started calling me Icky.
We think your head fans great, but love that Icky, Icky shade.
Meanwhile, the 49ers were building a winning streak of their own. A Monday night game against the world champion Redskins featured the talents of kick returner John Taylor.
Taylor fields the ball at the 5-yard line, which is unusual to begin with.
Wins over San Diego and Atlanta, showcased the trusted trio of Montana, Rice, and Craig, often in spectacular fashion.
Got it, Jerry Rice, wide open!
It's all over. Here's the leader.
And in week 15, the return match with New Orleans provided an unexpected party, with the Saints reverting to their self-destructive ways of old, handing the 49ers a victory that secured their playoff berth. A week later, they were division champions.
We've been to the playoffs a lot, and three Super Bowls in the 80s, championships would be nice. And like I said, we got a long way to go with them.
Cincinnati were roaring towards the playoffs until they visited the House of Pain. The Houston Oilers brought the Bengals down to earth with a resounding thud, handing them their biggest defeat of the season. On the final weekend, they needed to beat the Super Bowl champions, Washington, to clinch the division title. Chip Lowmiller let them off the hook with a missed field goal at the end of regulation. And Jim Breach snatched the all-important victory in overtime.
Oh, it feels great to come in the league my first year and help a team win the Central Division. And it feels great. There's no emotions or no words for it. It's just a great feeling.
In the playoffs, San Francisco began to look dominant, sweeping all obstacles aside en route to Miami.
Second down. Craig is out of the open. And off to the races. Roger Craig. Turn it on, Roger. Taylor is split wide to the left and Rice to the right. Montana back to throw it. To right. That's caught by Jerry Rice, and look out for this one.
This could be as good a team as San Francisco's had. And I'd have to say that in my 10 years with San Francisco, this is our biggest road victory, greatest victory on the road we've ever had. And I'm really pleased and privileged to be around the guys that have done it.
The home field advantage proved crucial to Cincinnati. In the jungle, the Bengals were untouchable all year. And in the playoffs, the Seahawks and then the Buffalo Bills became the prey of the Tiger Stripe Man-Eaters.
I don't feel like jumping up and down. I just hugged every player in there. Just told them all I loved them in a brotherly way. I have seen the owner of the club in tears over the joy of winning this thing. I've seen a stadium in hysteria because they've supported the team and seen it succeed.
But the ultimate test remains for the Bengals. They end the season a perfect 10-0 at home in the jungle. But can they beat the 49ers in Miami?
The Bengals handily, and my old team, the Falcons, for a change, did something good and thrashed the 49ers. Wilder, do you think we have the two best teams in the NFL here today?
I think we have the two best balanced teams in the NFL here today. As far as the two best teams, I think they're still at home. But because they put the combination together, they're here.
If these aren't the two best, which two teams would you like to see here?
I would like to see the Bears here, simply because because I played with them, and it would be a lot easier doing the game as opposed to doing this one here. The other team I would like to see there would be the Houston Oilers.
All right. Well, I think we've got two good teams here, and we also have a good city. And now let's take a look at the host city and the magnificent stadium in which the game will be played.
The city of Miami is set on the southern tip of Florida, and it has a great climate. But there is more to the city than being a holiday resort. The population is made up of many cultures, and the people that live here come from all over the American continent. And because of that, Miami has become a big financial center for a lot of South American countries.
But the pride of Miami is a new football stadium, which is where Super Bowl 23 will be played. It's the world's first privately financed, multi-purpose stadium. And it was named after the Dolphins' owner and the man who conceived the whole project, Joe Robbie. The Dolphins played in the Orange Bowl for 20 years. Why did you move?
Well, we moved because we built a new stadium that would give comfort and convenience to our fans, give them plenty of parking space, comfortable seating, all the amenities that people that pay for professional football in this country ought to have. We simply needed a new stadium. The city and the county seemed paralyzed and did nothing about renovating the Orange Bowl or building a new stadium. The seats were extremely uncomfortable. They were only 17 inches in width, and everybody has a wider bottom than that that came to any of our games. So we built a state-of-the-art stadium that has every seat a chairback seat with armrests, every one of them with a clear and unobstructed view to the field, 10,200 special seats with stadium club privileges, and 231 skyboxes. And the people that put up the money to build the skyboxes and the club seat holders are the ones that made it possible for somebody like me to finance the stadium. There's never been a stadium built for multi-purposes or a football stadium or coliseum since the Roman Empire or even before that. It's never been done by private investment before. This Super Bowl 23 was awarded to Miami at an NFL meeting in Phoenix in March of 1985. That's 4 years ago. And at that time, the place you're looking at was a sand dune. The NFL thought enough of our credibility so that when we asked them to put the 1989 Super Bowl in our new stadium, they voted it here, even though there were motorcycles out here drag racing in the sand on the site on which this game's going to be played.
Now, you've also planned this stadium for different events rather than football. What type of events are you going to put in here?
Well, the World Cup's coming here in 1994, and it's never been in the United States before. And FIFA, the international governing body of soccer, says that one of the main reasons they're coming here is because of the existence of this stadium. This is the only stadium in America that doesn't have to be modified in some way in order for World Cup to be played here.
Are you going to get the World Cup final here? The
final
for 1994?
And you'd better bet that we're the favorite.
So a great setting for Super Bowl 23, and who knows, maybe we'll see the World Cup in 1994 from the same stadium. During the year, we've brought you some of the more humorous moments from the week's play. For tonight's program, we've put together the best of the year.
We start our look at the alternative plays of the year with players who had to deal with some wayward snaps. The Detroit Lions gave us lots of entertainment. Who will ever forget punter Jim Arnold throwing on fourth down from his own end zone? Ex-coach Darryl Rogers really blowing his top. And it was all too much for quarterback Rusty Hilger. Finally, two Lions players decided to end it all, kamikaze style. And it proved so popular that other teams tried it too. Donald Igwebegwe decided to remove his groin after he saw these two close calls. And the referees were more involved in some of the action than they would really have liked. Steve Largent gets the Revenge Award of the Year. In week one, he got nailed by Dennis Harden. He then waited 15 weeks before getting even. And Redskins' Joe Jacoby was caught changing his underwear on the sidelines. It was a pity he didn't tell this guy about using a towel. And finally, the agility honors go to Kelly Stouffer of the Seahawks, Willie Gault of the Raiders, Ray Alexander from Dallas, whose catches inspired many a celebration during the 1988 NFL season.
Welcome back. During the week, the players are constantly bombarded by questions at media free-for-alls, which some players feel is as intimidating as the game itself. Fortunately, I was able to talk with some of the Bengals in more relaxed surroundings, and I started by asking some of the veterans about their last Super Bowl appearance against the 49ers in the Pontiac Silverdome in Detroit. Chris, is there any difference this time around?
Yeah, about 8 years, man. I'm an old man now. I can remember then I could run around all night, stay out, entertain the troops, and then get up at 7 o'clock in the morning and not feel any worse for it. Now, I don't know if that same theory holds true. I've got to take care of myself a little bit more now. But as far as our football team goes, we've got a good team. This is a younger team than we took in 81 when we played the 49ers then. But they're handling everything amazingly well. This is a team with a sense of humor, and I think that's what you have this week. The media crunch is just unbelievable, and our guys seem to be enjoying it.
I'll tell you, having played in it and lost, I think it's almost worse than not having played in it at all. You realize later on how close you were to having the ring that says world champion on it versus one that just says AFC champion. And I think there's a certain amount of respect that comes from just having a team among your peers that made it to the Super Bowl. And then obviously if you win the Super Bowl, it makes it that much nicer. So I think that it's something that you can really take with you. You know, nobody can take it away from you 15 years from now.
I tell you honestly, we've had more fun in the 2 days that we've been here already than we've had the entire week in Pontiac. It was just so cold. And Pontiac is not even Detroit. We didn't even get in to go into the city of Detroit and have some fun. Whereas here, everywhere we go, somebody's looking to entertain us, and they've done a good job of it.
What do you feel you need to do to beat the 49ers?
Well, the first thing we have to do is somehow try to keep the ball out of their offense or away from their offense. Obviously, that will mean trying to establish the running game and throw when we want to throw, not when we have to throw. And I think that if we're able to do that, we'll be able to beat them because we'll keep Joe Montana and those guys off the field.
The last 2 years, you've run for almost 3,000 yards. What's the big difference?
Well, primarily a new attitude on life that you have to live one day at a time and live it to the fullest and take every opportunity and try to expand it and get over, really.
How much does your offensive line help you?
This year, they helped me tremendously. Last year, they helped me tremendously, too, because they were putting hats on the guys and opening holes where I could run through, because God gave me the ability with my running talent, but all I needed was big guys up front so I can really utilize it.
The offensive line is opening 5-yard holes. I've never seen anything quite like it, and they deserve a lot of credit for that. And I think that our blocking schemes and with the ability of James Brooks, Stanley Wilson, and Stanford Jennings, and Icky Woods to be able to read those blocking schemes has really been tremendous, and that's one of the things that has been real good for us.
How good do you think your backfield is?
Well, it's hard to say. We have so many players that do different types of things. That James Brooks is a quick outside type of runner who can catch passes out of the backfield. Icky Woods, for a big man, moves as well as any back in the league, and he also has great hands coming out of the backfield. And I think Stanley Wilson could be the best short yardage back in the league. So there are a lot of things that we do well back there, and hopefully those things will come again on Sunday.
Maybe the key to this football game is going to be how well our wide receivers block their safeties. Ronnie Lott plays like a fifth linebacker up there. And if you don't account for him in the running game, then you're not going to run the football all day long. And so that's going to be our job. You know, Ronnie Lott's got about 30 pounds on me, so I'm probably going to come out of it with one of those Excedrin headaches.
The good thing about our running game is that when teams defend against us, they have to sometimes bring 8 and 9 guys around a line of scrimmage, and that what that usually means is that Eddie Brown or Timmy McGee or Collinsworth or Rodney Holman are one-on-one with somebody, and we'll take that matchup with anybody.
What sort of balance do you think you'll need on Sunday to beat the 49ers with the running and passing?
Well, you know, I'd like to see us gain over 200 yards rushing and about 250 yards passing, but then again, I'd like to see that in every game.
Can you tell us a little bit of the history behind the ponytail and the Icky Shuffle?
There's really no history. It's just that I feel I play better with long hair, and the Icky Shuffle just came about when I was at home just kicking back and just acting wild, and just came up with a little wild dance I was going to do to celebrate a touchdown.
I hope you do it a lot on Sunday.
Oh, yeah, hopefully so.
Let's do the wild thing. Wild. Wow, fine.
Well, Icky Woods has been shuffling all week as the media machine has focused its attention on him, including the Cincinnati radio station, who've been broadcasting live from the hotel lobby all week. Well, Icky will be looking to do the shuffle a few more times in the end zone today, and the running game will be a key to a Cincinnati victory. Well, Icky has been a crowd pleaser. Experts here in Miami make the Bengals heavy underdogs. That suits head coach Sam Weish, who says they started the season as rank outsiders and accomplished the biggest turnaround in NFL history. So the pressure's off the Bengals. They should be loose and ready to create havoc for the 49ers with their innovative offense. Back to you, Mick.
Thanks, John. Walter, what do you think the Bengals have to do to beat the 49ers?
Well, Boomer said it. They got to be able to throw when they want to and not when they have to. That's the key. But first, they also got to throw to the running backs, because if they can't get the ball into the running back's hands just by running the ball, you're playing against real good defenses on both sides of the field, and you just won't be able to just run up in there. You got to use some plays to get the ball into the running back's hand outside the line of scrimmage, and they got to throw to the running backs. I think San Francisco has the best edge on that in that category.
All right. Well, we'll be hearing from the 49ers in a few minutes, but first we're going to have to show you the segment of the show, which I'm not sure Walter, John, or myself have really been looking forward to, and I think in particular me. Well, if some of those players make the same mistakes this week as they did last week, we might still be smiling, but I don't think they will be, because they're probably going to be on the waiver wire. Next week, Walter Payton will be with us, and he'll be coming from Denver, where he'll be interviewing. Well, if some of those players make the same mistakes next week.
The first time I came to New England, that we had a first meeting, and they said, everybody stand up one at a time, introduce themselves, the veterans and the rookies. And I remember this guy stand up and go, John Smith, Southampton, England. I went, what the hell was that?
He said,
he's not from around here.
Yo, blood. I'm just hanging.
Looking good, bro.
Thank you. So you guys need translation?
Well, if some of those players make the same mistakes next week, we know me.
In this free market atmosphere, where there are so many similar products available to the public, companies are always looking for something to give them the edge over the competition. Advertising in print and television. In this free market atmosphere, where there are so many products available to the consumer.
Public.
In this free market atmosphere, where there are so many similar products available to the public.
I picked up three of them.
Right now, I'm going to try and get out of Houston and beat Atlanta, like everyone else does. Those were the days when that's all I had to worry about, snapping a ball. Then in the AFC, we've got Buffalo versus Houston.
I'm going to pick Buffalo simply because they're playing at home and they're so hungry for a win.
How you been, Lucky?
Hey, we do.
We're doing television right now.
I'm sorry. Did I just...
Yeah.
You're not live, are you?
No.
I'm back here now with the Bears. They now know that the 49ers will be their next opponent. Opponent? I'm now back with the 49ers. They now know... Back here with the Falcons, and we're in the playoffs for the first time in 20 years. Guys, how does it feel? Well, if some of those players make the same mistakes next week, we might still be laughing, but they won't, because they'll probably be on the waiver wire. Next week, Walter Payton will be up in Denver interviewing Tony Dorsett, the man who's chasing his all-time rushing record. John Smith will also be with us. But before that, we've got our Tuesday show at 5 o'clock. So join us then. Have a good week. End. Good night. Back. So we've heard the opinions of the Bengals. Now to the 49ers, who Walter caught up with during the week.
In case you're wondering what the Super Bowl is all about, it's not about money, it's about this thing that I'm holding in my hand. And this signifies two Super Bowl wins.
Number three is the way to go, Walter. That's really what we want.
Tell you what, this is unbelievable. You are the guy who really makes things happen, because if you don't play well, then the offense doesn't go well.
That's been sort of the MO for our entire offense all year long. It's an old cliche, but everything started for us up front. When our line plays well, Joe can click, Roger can click, Jerry can click, but if we're not picking things up properly up front, we've had some pretty weak performances.
I think the biggest thing is keeping the ball out of their offense. Both teams, while our defense has been playing well, their defense has to have been playing well. I don't think the numbers at the end of the year reflect as well as their defense is playing, because you know as well as anyone, for anyone to get to the Super Bowl, the defensive team has to be playing well. They have to be stopping people. So our thing is try to keep them away from putting the pressure on our defense with that no-huddle offense and the crazy things that they do offensively. So if we can keep ball control, which is a key, which is hopefully is a, what we do naturally anyway.
Well, like all performances when we're playing as big games like this, the running game is what's going to tell the game, and it's going to be told what's up front, you know, because our offensive line, you know, they have to win it up front, and for me to run the ball and for Joe to get the protection to get the ball to Jerry downfield. So it's a matter of who wanted the baddest, and I think we got experience and we've been there before, and hopefully we can display that.
Well, I think it's an unusual matchup for us because we usually go into a game as the undersized group. We're generally playing against guys much larger than us. This week we're playing against people that are basically about our size. So that usually tells you they're a lot quicker than a normal defensive lineman you play against. They're going to stunt more. They're going to blitz more. But in general, I think it's a pretty good matchup because we've developed a fairly strong running game around here the last couple of years.
The emotion have to be there. You know, you have to kind of put away all the distractions all throughout the week, especially right now. You know, we're like 3 days away from the game, and you have to have your minds keyed on what you're doing. And I think Sunday the guys will know how to turn up another notch.
With all the media hype and everything surrounding this game, is it hard to keep your concentration on the game at hand?
Well, I think at times it might be early on in the first week or so, but once we get down here, I think your focus becomes more upon the game. Even though the media's there, it's kind of a limited session that we have every day, and thank God for that, because then I think it could really get out of hand.
I enjoy sort of the hoopla and the attention that the Super Bowl brings, so it doesn't really make me shy away from anything. I mean, we've told the younger players that aren't used to this that they got to go with it. They got to really loosen up and enjoy it, because I think the way you can really get uptight in Super Bowl week is to fight against it and pretend you're not really noticing it.
But we don't get much time to enjoy the weather and that, but at night it's been relaxing. We got a fair amount of time off, and we're enjoying it as much as we can with trying to still keep a focus on the game.
They do have two excellent backs. Icky Woods, you know, he's had a phenomenal year, and James Brooks is not shabby either, you know. So I think they probably have the two best tandem backs in the league right now. But Tom Rathman and myself, we do have a different style, more of a punishing and slasher type of runners. And I think we get the job just as well as those two do.
Well, they've got some incentive. They don't have any more players that played in that game than we do. I mean, we're talking about half a dozen people on both sides of the ball. Mm-hmm. So there's some incentive for the veteran players, but these young guys have no idea what the 81 Super Bowl was. I mean, they were in the sixth grade watching it on TV with their folks.
Last time I talked to you, you were having problems.
Well, I think hopefully things have turned around, but I still feel that there's always that possibility that he'll use Steve because Steve's a good player. Hopefully we won't get back into that controversy because of the way things have been going, but it all ended on the play of one game last year, and hopefully it won't end that way again.
Got the receipt, Roger Craig, in the end zone. Will there be a Roger Craig shuffle?
No, I'm not into the shuffle. I just, you know, I might spike it or two, but other than shuffling, no, I don't do any extra activities after I score.
Good. You're off to the Pro Bowl. But first, it's the Super Bowl. I want to wish you best of luck in both.
Well, thanks a lot, Walter. Okay. This guy is my idol, so, hey.
Well, Walter, they look very confident. What do you think they need to do to win today?
What they got to do is they got to establish some type of running game and the short intermediate passes to the wide receivers and the running backs, because if they don't have that, then they won't be able to move the ball.
Okay, so what about the passing game then?
The passing game has got to be Jerry Rice and the tight end, because what they're going to be doing is they're going to be doubling up on those two. So what he's going to have to do is go to them early and then start coming back to the running backs.
All right. Well, to get an impartial view on the game, I talked to Houston's head coach, Jerry Glanville. Jerry, here in Miami, you're at the site of the Super Bowl. You guys came so close. How does it feel?
I think you're better off having a bad football team that you know doesn't belong, that you don't deserve to be there. I think the problem with us is we're so close that a couple of plays and maybe we're here. Cincinnati's here, who, of course,
we were able
to beat during the year, and I think it makes it harder by having such a good football team.
Now, all through the year, you've left tickets for Phantom of the Opera, Elvis, etc.
James Dean, don't forget James back. Dean.
Good old James. Who would you leave them for the Super Bowl?
I think when you're in Miami Beach, you have to leave them for the great one, Jackie Gleason, who did his shows down here, and one of my
right, so 50 seconds.
Really TV stars I love to watch.
Yeah, looking at both teams, where do you see their strengths and weaknesses?
Very similar. They are number one and number two.
I'll do that at the very end.
I'll
bring Stanley Wilson.
Running the football, they get their reputation by throwing it, but they throw to get ahead, and they get ahead in the game, and then they run the football.
So our opinions are divided. But what about John, who's outside the state?
Really, two similar teams offensively.
How would you stop Montana, Craig, and Rice?
Really, I think what you do is you play zone underneath and try to hit them after they make the short pass. It's a long handoff. It's not an extended. Deep ball down the field. Don't blitz. If you throw a blitz at him, Rice scores a touchdown. So play zone, drop off, get as many people in the zone as they got.
No, you were fine
there. Try to rally up and hit them after they catch it.
Okay, as far as Cincinnati, Boomer and company, you did beat them earlier in the year. How did you manage that?
We got ahead of them, took them out of the game plan, got ahead real early. I think we maybe had them like 21 and 24 nothing at halftime, so it really took them out of the game and put pressure on the Boomer, get after the Boomer with as many folks as you can. The weakness, I think, of the Cincinnati Bengals is, well, to win the game, their field goal kicker cannot kick the long field goal. It'll be a short field goal. But the ball will be sitting at the 16-yard line on the right hash, and he'll kick it through to win the game. And the team in the league with the ugliest helmets will be all excited. They'll be jumping up and down.
So you're picking Cincinnati to win by three?
By 3 points off a breach field goal, which, you know, years from now, people will know Breach's name. Without this game, he'd be just another kicker.
Well, congratulations on this season. Hopefully we'll see you in Super Bowl 24 next year.
Thank you very much. Hope to see you in either Cornwall in, or Devonshire, one of those good places down the southwest.
So as entertaining as ever, Jerry Glanville casting his vote for the Bengals. But Walter, who are your favorites?
Well, both of these teams are very capable of winning the Super Bowl. I like San Francisco simply because they're from the NFC.
Well, I much prefer Cincinnati. I think their offensive line is going to dominate. I think they're going to be able to run the ball. I think Boomer's going to have a big day. He's just got a lot of commercials coming in, a lot of endorsements. I think he's a great leader. And I think Brooks and Woods are two of the better tandems, as Craig said, in the league. They complement each other very well. And my pick is Cincinnati, 24, the San Francisco 49ers, 21.
Well, my score was a little bit different. I had 21-17. 49ers, but you said you made a good point. If Boomer is on, then they got a real good chance of winning because the last two games he has not had real good games.
So our opinions are divided, but what about John, who's outside the stadium? Who do you favor to win?
Well, I'm with you, Mick, and all these Bengals fans, including ex-Bengal wide receiver Ronnie Allgood, agree with us. 7 hours before the kickoff, people started to gather at the stadium to start the party rolling early. The weather's been beautiful all week, but yesterday and early this morning we had a downpour, and the weathermen tell us there's a 70% chance of rain during the game. But the field's in fine condition, as the groundsman kept it covered during the rainstorms. So who's gonna win, guys?
Bengals!
Bengals!
Hooday!
Well, John, Walter, and myself will be back in 3 hours' time at 9:45 to bring you the whole game live, including at halftime the best of our music segments from the season. So I hope you can join us later for the season's climax, Super Bowl 23. But for the moment, goodbye from Miami.